Hello again. These colored pearls have been difficult to pull up and find, but I believe I've found one that contains more information on his experiments than the previous set did. This arrangement of information covers the case logs of several mutated hybrid experiments. I noticed a majority of these creatures aren't even native to his regions, so it's heavily theorized that DNA traces may have been stolen by some other means. Regardless of this, let's read over what we have this time. With my knowledge of the living and bleeding, little of it has spent studying the organics of plants. However, knowledge in flora is still required in my field. Crossbreeding the genetic matter of the pole plant and the monster kelp resulted in a taxing flower I have dubbed the Hydrocera. The organism stands at exactly 3.5 meters tall, four tall spiky vines that stand tall in the air, with eight blossoming leaves on each side. Each leaf is covered top to bottom with small, sticky spines coated in a sweet-smelling substance. It is capable of luring in smaller insects or low-intelligent specimens. In addition, the leaves of the Hydrocera stay low to the ground and are visibly difficult to spot for those with poor perception. Once the Hydrocera has achieved grip on its meal, it will collapse all required leaves into the core of the vines of the plant. While the vines help maintain a sort of strangulation of the prey, it releases an acidic chemical that slowly dissolves the food. The Hydrocera has been fed meat, plants, and other mineral substances, all of which have been successfully dissolved in a one-cycle period. The dissolved proteins of the Hydrocera's food are sent into the core roots of the plant, which feeds the overall specimen. Buried roots beneath the soil will take a percentage of the proteins and spread them into the surrounding area of the plant. Because of this, Hydrocera are seen reproducing themselves in an octagonal pattern. Attempting to plant the seed of a Hydrocera on fresh soil has proven ineffective, as the plant will only grow on decomposed matter, regardless of the freshness. Dismemberment of the Hydrocera has proven ineffective and dangerous. As tested, if any of the vines or leaves become dislodged, two more will grow back to take its place. Given patience, to my discovery, this repetitive process can seemingly happen indefinitely. As a prior of its release, I ended up with the Hydrocera with a total of 72 arms, which still remains with me as I speak. Overall testimonies, Hydrocera seeds will be released through airborne transmitters into every region. Within time, the graves of their fallen will have been desecrated. Considering the mass of those impure souls who perish before being granted salvation, carrion is not difficult to find. Their bodies will finally hold a place in the Great Plan. If I could speak to the dead, what honor they must feel. This bioweapon is complete. Moving on to the next one. The disgusting parasitic creatures of this world fail to entertain me. However, using their tactics to my advantage may prove useful. Retracting DNA from the common red leech was simple, but very infuriating to collect due to their isolated locations, all of which exist nowhere near me. Nevertheless, I eventually got what I needed. Splicing genetic matter between these two was easier than expected, which is a relief as mass production will commence. The Bobbit Wig is a slender, double-jawed organism, an outside set of mandibles that are designed to pierce into the flesh of the body and lower them into a second set of jaws, which gnash at the prey to ingest its blood. The creature is extensive and highly flexible, as no bones have been created. Instead, it is supported by a soft skeleton of cartilage, which allows the Bobbit Wig to safely crush itself into smaller holes. The long intestine-like neck acts as both a throat and a digestive tract, all while the body of the Bobbit Wig remains latched in place. The specimen patiently locks itself on the floor or walls of underwater transmitters. Its antenna is very sensitive to movement, and can locate any subtle changes in the water all around it. Any movement that is detected will cause the creature to quickly lunge itself forward to gnash itself into any unsuspecting food. Once the creature is locked into place, it is dragged down into the Bobbit Wig's den underwater. The corpse of the disheveled organism is soon disposed of after its body has been drained. Despite this creature's sophistication in predatory tactics, it serves a secondary use. Bobbit Wigs will be mass-produced and implanted into pipe infrastructures of opposing iterators. A select few of us still use aquatic transport for pearls and other precious objects. Bobbitwigs will be able to fish out any of these data modules that are going through transit and ingest them to their second stomach. These collected pearls will be flushed back towards me for my own observation. If they, say, detect these creatures and attempt to flush them out or remove them in some way, they cannot do so without risking the information that they've already lost. Any secrets shared between them, I will know as well. It is better that their risks be handled by me than by those who cannot comprehend it. These weapons are complete. I am successful. Moving on to the next one. Combining the fauna and flora is something that I have been instructed by my peers not to attempt. However, despite all their gawks, I was successful as always. The deer that trample through my withering gardens of neglect have been infused with the fungal pods that they seemed to ingest so wholesomely. This experiment had taken me years of commitment to finally see results. The final project's name will be called The Wasting. The fungal spore puffs have been adapted to properly inhabit the deer's body. The deer that I had kept for this procedure had shown no signs of sapience or self-awareness. Almost like I was speaking to a living corpse. The idea of the fungus adapting a mind of its own is not something I plan on studying this very moment, purely because I already know the answer. The fungus festers the inside of the deer's skull and underbelly. The dustings of these fungi release spores from the deer's stomach that scatter across the ground wherever it walks, leaving a large blanket of mycelium that eventually grows into more spore puffs. This mycelium is also known to corrode, then ingest, several types of minerals and artificials, with the exception of lead for some odd reason. Regardless of that, the stems of the fungus are able to intercept its way through most materials. This includes our technology. I learned this the hard way. But no matter. The walkers are being released into further distant regions of the world to spread the cause of mycelium even more. As of recent events, I made a discovery that the reindeer are not the only creatures that this fungus will inhabit. Creatures such as spiders, centipedes, and other invertebrates have also been infected. The only difference being they are not so easily manipulated like the deer. Instead of being piloted to spread more spores for long periods of time, they can only survive while being infected for what seems like a couple of hours, before the fungus grows outside of their body and starts shedding itself even more. Other smaller mammals seem to be barely affected by these spores. At the very least, it causes skin irritation and swelling in their throat. Regardless of this, I still find the deer to be a more reliable transmute for this operation. One deer is enough to infect the entirety of the eastern farmarays. My plan is to coat as many regions as possible with this fungal net. Once I have reached an optimal threshold, they will be set ablaze by the magpie, causing destruction across all borders. Bioweapon complete. Mission successful. At its mention, I suppose now is a good time. No prior genetic code was sampled during the creation of this experiment, for it is entirely robotic. Throughout the cause of my necessary destructions directed towards my acquaintances, Overseer computer systems can only carry my will so far, and so well. I have messengers of my own, much more exotic and superior than the common rodent that my neighbors seem to be so pitifully fond of. This aerial masterpiece I have named the Magpie is of my own design, an artificial corvid designed for carrying my influence wherever it be needed. The avian is armored with steel plating around its body, while the neck and wings are structured with the more flexible plastic and aluminum mesh. The talons of the Magpie are designed to lock into a vice grip, restricting movement for any transporting experiments. This will maintain a sturdy grip while not entirely harming the specimen, as any excessive damage to the flesh or DNA could make the diagnostics complicated. Despite this, the Magpie is not at all incapable of causing damage. I have realized that despite the excessive amount of water near my younger peers, much of its natural ecosystem and structures are not at all immune to pyrotechnics. Thus being stated, the Magpie is supplied with a retractable flame ballistic which is located in the back of its throat. The intensity of the flame can be self-adjusted. The lowest setting can provide simple smoke screens, while the highest can provide a piercing white flame, which allows the Magpie to cut holes through solid materials in order to access sealed-off corridors. The flame can be adjusted to only spark at repetitive intervals, causing a firestorm of pellets. Or a common tactic, which is simply scorching the earth. My original reason for creating the Magpie was to hunt and capture messengers sent by opposing iterators, preventing them from spreading any more misinformation they've been ignorantly carrying. Despite my best attempts, information transit was still out of my complete control. I have since upgraded the Magpie with a more clear perception, with three eyes on each side and the ability to detect movement through heat, sound, and ultraviolet light. Nothing escapes it now. Alongside that, it is also used for transporting specimens across borders that are too far for me to reach. At first, this creature was a simple tool. I felt no need to document it. However, it has since been upgraded to a more menacing threat. The Magpie is of my own, and is in of itself another weapon. The diverse reptilian population is something that's always intrigued me. While I find many options available to me, there is one that has always piqued my interest. Relocating both aggressive creatures was tough for my messenger, but nonetheless successful. Due to both organisms sharing the same genetic foundation, I blindly assumed it to be a simple task. For the most part, it was. However, during the final growth cycles, every experiment that had managed to survive was pronounced dead due to a spontaneous eruption of cranial overstimulation. This process failed several times. I was close to ending the experiment permanently. However, an idea struck me. I had borrowed keyprints from another senior, a hulking cybernetic creature she had been holding for some time now. Improvising, I had implemented these head designs into the specimen, and to my conclusion, it was a success. The lizard's head is no longer organic. It is now being supported by hydraulic cybernetics. The brain of the lizard is contained in an internal structure of the machine. Due to the threat of the lizard's original head blowing up, the brain had to be grown separate from the body and placed in manually, which of course was a very delicate process. The jaws of the beasts are operable and extremely powerful. Testing the specimen's jaw strength has concluded a 100% lethality range, as it has bisected every living organism I could sacrifice. Outside of organic material, its jaw strength is estimated to crush over 2,000 psi of force, which goes outside the capability of harming just simple life. In addition to a powerful bite, the lizard's ability to jump was also maintained. However, I assume because of the overburdening weights of its head, its jump is slightly lower than its original predecessor. I had temporarily used it to dispose of failed projects that were just taking up space. Over time, the creature's eventual ability to spit had conjoined with its synthetic diet. The congested spit balls that the lizard would use to his advantage have integrated with its material diet, and are more akin to blood clots with rusted chunks of metal. The specimen is incredibly aggressive, and shows no obedience towards me. Because of this, I have released it to the outside of my facility grounds to ingest the scrapped projects and any decomposing metal. As frustrating as that is to me, it is not a complete waste of my time. Bioweapon complete. On to the last one. All of the arachnid organisms that nest across these regions share the same genetic foundation. At first, I thought the idea to be pointless, but in my solemn states of boredom, I attempted the undesirable. In the beginning, the genetic amalgamation of all spiderling species was as I expected, nothing but a simple, basic arachnid mush of its predecessors. I debated throwing it out, but over time I began to notice that this creature began to gradually grow in size. This intrigued me. I kept it alive day after day, only to see it manifest into this supermassive abomination. The seamstress, as I refer to it now, has grown into a monstrous size, a catastrophic amalgamation of every spider species I could locate. The creature possesses a cloning process, similar to the Ark in previous examinations. However, instead of its offspring detaching from the mother, they simply add themselves into the swarm and increase its density. I have lost track of where the brood mother is located, but my best guess is somewhere deep in the front of the hive. Strangely, the seamstress has a constant desire to provide silky bedding in every secluded corridor it can find, something none of its predecessors have shown doing, at least none that I have observed. The silk provided from the seamstress is laced in a paralyzing excretion that freezes joint movement and kills the nerves. Mummification in this webbing will cause the prey to experience an overstimulation of poison, which results in, for lack of a better term, total brain death. All of which the colony, and the seamstress herself are completely immune to. As I document, the seamstress grows in size. However, after discovering the erratic growth of the specimen, it was disposed of entirely. My overseers have not located her anywhere near my facility or resting grounds. I can only assume that she has found a better foundation. Why I did not exterminate it while I had the chance? I'm sure many will ask me that question. Others may see creeping death, while my eyes are open to opportunity. Regardless, it's out of my hands now. I'm sure once it reaches an overbearing size, maybe I will contribute to burning it down. But until that day comes, I have work to do. There is always more work to be done.